Rock photographer Christian Treber talks about his time with the band Badfinger, one of the most unluckiest bands in the history of rock and roll. I'm John Beaudin from Rock History Music. When it comes to talking to Christian Treber, who has amazing photographs on his website, we're going to give away three, by the way, and we'll let you know about that in just a second. Three prints autographed by Christian. But when you talk about being there, you know, the first clip we have of Christian was him hanging out with Jimi Hendrix, and he's got the pictures to prove it. He got to know Keith Moon of The Who really, really well. He also got to know Badfinger. When you talk about unlucky bands, you know, sure, we talk about Creedence Clearwater Revival and how they were screwed, Grand Funk Railroad, but really, I'd put on top of the list, Badfinger. When they got caught up with Stan Pauly, everything changed. Here was a band with hits like Come and Get It, No Matter What, Day After Day, Baby Blue, who were really not making any money. And according to many, signing with Stan Pauly was a huge mistake. All the money they made under his supervision was never received by the band. In fact, years after the group was gone, solicitors in the UK said it wasn't even worth trying to get the money anymore, in fears that a lawsuit might have Pauly's estate going after the UK funds. We should point out that Stan Pauly died on July 20th, 2009. Got so bad that Pete Ham, who was one of the driving forces in the band, took his own life on April 24th, 1975. He was only 27. Tommy Evans would do the same thing on November 19th, 1983. He was only 36. Mike Gibbons died of a brain aneurysm on October 4th, 2005. He was 56. Only Joey Mulland is still around, and he sometimes tours under the name Badfinger. Now, before we show you the clip of Christian, it's part one of our conversation with Christian about Badfinger. We're going to have a giveaway of three prints autographed by Christian Treber. First of all, you have to be a member. You have to have subscribed to this channel. Two, you have to go into his website. The link will be in the description of this video. You have to pick which print you'd like to win, and then just put it in the description of this video. And in exactly 1 week, 7 days, we're going to pick three winners, and he'll send them to you, autographed. Here's our clip with Christian Treber talking about taking pictures and hanging out with Badfinger.
This is the saddest story in rock and roll. To me, it's just sad. When people talk about bad managers and bad luck, Badfinger's the first name that comes to mind for a lot of people.
Right. I mean, I got to know Bill and his wife quite well. He was a really down-to-earth ex-musician, really nice guy, working on an idea to basically help people learn music and to be able to write and compose without really having that much knowledge of music. And he was almost like a father to all of us. He was that type of guy. The mistake was he just didn't know the business as well. And when he wanted to get an American manager because Badfinger was blowing up in this country, he unfortunately didn't do the right thing. Because I've always told people, if a person starts flashing famous names that they manage, look into the background and find out why he's no longer managing them. And in most cases, you're going to find out it's because he ripped them off. Like Alan Klein, which Paul McCartney's father-in-law found out about. So he told Paul not to sign with him, and Paul wanted to go his way, and the rest of the Beatles went with Alan Klein. But if they checked, they would have found that all they would have had to do was ask the Rolling Stones. He ripped the Rolling Stones off for millions of dollars.
Yeah, and it's commonplace too. I just finished talking to some of the background Elton John people, and it's amazing how much money was being thrown around. And I mean, in rock and roll, when you're young, they don't pay attention. These young musicians, they don't pay attention sometimes to.
That's why the Stones have done as well, because Mick Jagger has a master's in accounting.
I found the relationship with Pete and Tommy, the fact that, you know, well, they wrote together, they were like comrades. I mean, Pete was 27 when he died, and Tom, 36. I mean, that's ridiculous.
Yeah, I know it. And I was with Tommy shortly before he died. He'd come to the United States to do a Badfinger tour. It was the best Badfinger band I saw other than the original band. I mean, I'd seen Joey several times. I wasn't that impressed. It was just very raw. But he hired really professional musicians. He hired Bob Jackson, who was in Badfinger for a while. After Joey left, then Pete left, and then Bob Jackson was brought in, and then Pete came back and stayed even with Bob Jackson in the band. Basically, in addition to that, he also had Tony Kaye from Yes.
Oh, is that
on
right?
Keyboard, plus other musicians. And it was an absolutely phenomenal show. It was at a place called Lupo's Heartbreak Hotel in Rhode Island, which still exists. very, very famous rock place. And after that, we went back to the hotel and hung out for a while and listened to a Dudley Moore and Peter Cook tapes. Pretty raunchy, but we were listening to that, laughing and talking and so forth. And then the next day, Tommy called me and told me the tour was canceled, that Joey had basically done it again and basically canceled the tour on him.
Oh, God.
He had said, to the booking agents and the people that this was a phony Badfinger, it wasn't a real Badfinger, and they should not book it. And they got a hold of the club owners and all that stuff, and the whole tour was canceled.
What year has it been?
I don't recall. It was probably 6 to 8 months before Tommy died.
When was the first time you talked to Tommy after Pete passed?
The first time I talked to him was on that tour. Actually, I can't say it either. It's probably, we talked about a couple of things on the phone. I was living in Manhasset at the time, and I had called him and contacted him in England about possibly working with the group and doing stuff over here for them. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, we'll talk about that when you come to the state. When we come to the States, he came to the States and more of the same crap. Well, the weird thing about it is when Warner Brothers sued, because what happened was they hadn't finished the albums to Warner Brothers' satisfaction. They wanted two albums cut in addition to the one that they had already cut in a row. And they hadn't fulfilled the contract, yet Warner Brothers had already paid the management millions of dollars. But instead of suing the manager, they sued Badfinger, which is what caused the problem with Pete. Yeah. Because all of a sudden he lost his car, his wife or his girlfriend was pregnant with his daughter Petra, and all heck broke loose, and him and Tommy went out drinking, and he came back very, very drunk, and then he made a desperate move, and like a lot of times people who are drunk do these type of things, he made a very desperate move, and he hung himself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he wasn't thinking clearly, but that was stacking, but it was piling on. When I get information on this, I'm going, couldn't get worse. Then I turn a corner in the story and it gets worse and it gets worse. And
Yeah.
Did you ever meet Stan?
Yes, I had, because of the fact that and I found out later on that they'd already hired him. I advised against it. But yeah, he took everybody out to dinner one night. Bill Collins, the group, and me.
And what was your impression?
I didn't like him. He just seemed very sleazy to me.
Yeah.
Now, there was a partner in the organization called Stan Poses. He, on the other hand, was the exact opposite side of the coin. Really nice, down-to-earth type of guy.
When I was talking to the Grand Funk guys, and they had their own problem, they were saying, no, we didn't have the worst person behind us. Badfinger had the worst person behind them.
Yeah. But as far as I understand, he was also connected with the mob. So was Creedence Clearwater Revival.
Yeah, that's another one.
Hope you enjoyed that. Remember, we have a contest going on with Christian Treber and his prints, the guy who's a celebrated rock and roll photographer. We're giving away 3 prints. You have to be a subscriber to this channel. You have to go into his website and pick what print you want to win. And in the comments section, just write down what print you'd like to win if we pick your name. And in 1 week exactly, we're going to make a draw and we'll let you know who wins. Something we're going to do a lot more on this channel. When we interview a band, they got a new album, we're going to say, hey, can you autograph 10? Can we give some away to our audience? It's our way of saying, hey, man, thanks for supporting us. We'll have more from Christian talking about Badfinger in a few days. Make sure you comment on our video, subscribe to our channel, and share our videos. I'm John Beaudin from Rocky Street Music.